are partially quarantined. There's like 150,000 people quarantined.
Wow.
And in Barcelona, they're increasing. So it's probably... Oh, and they made it illegal to not wear a mask outside on Thursday.
Wow. We're doing pretty good here, and people are getting apathetic, and I'm pretty sure that it's going to be a big problem. Although we did just have an outbreak in one of our hospitals where one of my brothers is.
Yeah,
we're actually close to being back to normal here. There's still restrictions. Mm-hmm. But we did just allow a gathering of 100 people now. They have been gathering of larger groups, but like at parties, you're allowed to have a party with like 100 people.
Hmm. Yeah.
If you want them.
Nice.
So and you're allowed to party again.
We've been doing that for a while now. Or been allowed to it. I'm boring. I don't party. but we have been allowed to it. And infections haven't been going up so far, at least not significantly. It's still pretty low for us here. So yeah. We're lucky.
Well, let's see. I mean, we'll see. At least online D&D wasn't hurt. I mean, that's probably one of the only kind of hobbies that kind of flourish in this time.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, World 20 was really slow there for like a month.
Yeah.
Like the first one, especially oh yeah, okay, I'm waiting on that roll to go through. Come on.
Yeah,
I've heard
half a minute later, like every other roll.
I've heard that they're going to take Gen Con online, like for free. Only if you want to play games, you have to kind of pay, but all the lectures and those kinds of activities are going to be free. You need to sign up or something like that.
That's super neat, because I don't like big crowds, so I haven't gone to any of those things, but I'm always like, oh, I want to do that.
Yeah,
it sounds fun, but like those huge crowds, not for me. And the noise and everything, like I would just get a massive headache really quick, I think.
Yeah.
But I have watched, like, they do stream some of the stuff online from some of the lectures.
Yeah.
Some of them, not all of them.
Yeah. Well, we'll see. It will be an interesting year, no doubt.
Yeah.
It's also an interesting year for the residents of the Sword Coast.
Good segue.
Nice segue, huh?
Yeah.
When isn't it? Yeah, actually, you're quite right. So, it seems like there's something going on between the giants who are uprising and the Illithids who seem to be everywhere. And you agreed to help a group of Tritons, also piloting a Nautiloid, like a stolen, converted Nautiloid, in their ambitious quest to capture a live Illithid and question him. They want to understand what's going on with the Illithid, so they want to capture one and question him. They modified your vessel to be less detectable by other Illithids. You went to your own business. They headed to the Old Owl Well, where they told you there is an Illithid outpost somewhere around that ruined village. You approached there with your own ship and noticed a minotaur overlooking a group of kobolds. They were basically working the lands, growing tomatoes and prunes and, I don't know, grapes. And the minotaur was simply sitting there on the staircases that leads to the tower, smoking a big cigar. And during your reconnaissance flight, you noticed that someone called the minotaur in, and he went out and handed what appeared to be skulls to those kobolds, and they hurried and kind of arranged them in a circle around the tower. And as you got closer to the tower, you decided to try at least to sneak to have Galen sneak into the tower and kind of let's snatch the wizard or something like that. Was the plan, right? Something to kind of hit the wizard or something like that.
One of the skulls, we did.
One of the skulls, right?
You pick one of them up.
Yeah. But someone pressed the wrong button and you flushed basically the farmer outside of the Nautilus in a weird angle. And basically all hell broke loose. So and at this point, most of you are inside the tower. Right after you watched this massive robot-like creature fall from the top of the tower on top of a small desk that was arranged like in the middle of the tower, crashing and, you know, blowing large clouds of dust. So this metallic shield guardian basically fell down from the top floor. After Galen basically attacked him. Galen was climbing, if I remember correctly, outside of the tower, right?
Yeah, and then in a window.
Yeah, and then into a window, hit this creature. The creature fell down. The Minotaur is there. Most of you are there. Who is outside? I think it was either Andrist.
I am. Quarren was also outside, I think.
Right.
I think so I was like at the door.
Yeah. Yeah, makes sense.
I'm still controlling, I think, my animated objects hitting the skull that's up there.
Right, right. So there are several skulls still up. I think my notes tell me that there are still either four or five of them. I think four. They are still hovering at the near the top of the tower, aiming their lethal beams down at you. And at this point, Anderist and Corian, you noticed the wizard, the red-robed wizard. He climbed up this contraption that sits on top of the tower, and he pressed a button. The crystal sphere kind of opened up. He went inside, sat inside it, closed the hatch, and started manipulating some controls there. That contraption started shooting purple lightning bolts into the sky, and then a rift in space-time appeared, and what appeared to be a brain emerged from that rift, like a massive, huge brain, the size of a moon, basically. And it has kind of small tentacles all around it. And I think that's where we stopped last time. Right?
Yeah, I think so.
We gotta take it out.
Okay.
Who do we take out first, the brain or the wizard?
The wizard.
Or the skulls. Yeah.
So
let's get up from the ground first.
I didn't write down whose turn was it, or did we kind of write after we ended the round?
Yeah.
Okay, so in this case...
I think we're back to the top.
Yeah, it makes sense. So in this case, it's Galen's turn. So Galen, what do you want to do?
Well, I probably didn't notice what was going on upstairs. I just heard it, probably.
Yeah.
I'm on, like, a middle floor. I think I'll run down and help them with the robot thing. So just quickly run down the stair from where it pushed it down, or just jump down as quick as I can, and then go over and attack that.
Okay, makes
again,
sense. So
again and again.
Great. So it's still prone.
I'm pretty sure it got up and attacked Brookwee last time.
Okay. Took me down if it did.
Okay.
So I think it's standing at the door, or maybe it was the Minotaur.
I think it was the Minotaur who charged Rukvi.
Something attacked Rukvi at least.
Yeah, I think it was the Minotaur. Miniature.
So, Minotaur. If it's still down, then I'll go attack it while it's down.
Yeah, do that.
I'm pretty sure it got up, but I'm fine with it still being down. So that is advantage. That's a good thing because that was a natural one in the first one. I'm rolling so poorly. I'll use a key point here. The first one with advantage was an 18, so that should hit. Next attack is a miss. It was only a 13, even with advantage. And then a 25 and a 26, so three hits.
Yes.
Only 24 points of damage.
Okay. So
and I'm
24.
Not going to try and stun it or anything.
Yeah, you know better than that.
Robot thing.
Yeah. So you hit it a couple of times. There are metallic chips kind of flying out of its armor, and it tries to get up. Anything else you want to do?
Nope. That's
okay.
It.
So in this case, it's Andrist's turn.
All right, so I'm at the base of the tower on the outside. All of the skulls are kind of pointed at the front door. I'm at the back. And that glass dome thing is still up there, right? And it's just shot a beam of energy up.
Yeah.
And I have my elemental with me.
Correct.
How tall is the tower?
I think we said something like 6
feet.
Yeah. 6 floors, like 6 times...
Right.
It was 4 floors, I think.
Yeah, pretty sure it was 4.
Four floors. Time, but yeah, okay.
But it's sometimes the towers are magical and they grow overnight.
I don't know. I know it's still like a 10-story tower.
You know, yeah. As it gets more excited, you know, the tower gets bigger. A lot of action's happening here, so yay, it gets bigger. It's totally fine. Yeah. Totally normal.
Need to see something. Oh, not having a printer has made it difficult for me.
Yeah. I just wanted to say that I kind of stopped that session. Stopped it. I think exactly session 48. This is 57 or 58 today, and no printer. Yeah.
Usually I print at the library, but the library is obviously closed. So what did we say? It was 60 feet. Or 40 feet.
40 Eight. Feet. That's 40 feet is fine. 40
feet. Okay. So I'm gonna use a bonus action to cast. Well, yeah, I'm gonna leave my elemental where he is, so he'll defend himself if he gets attacked.
Okay.
But I'm gonna bonus action far step to the top of the tower.
Okay. Good.
And then I can still cast a spell. If it is a cantrip, right?
Yes.
When I get up to the top, is there a door or opening on that?
Good question. As you materialize at the top of the tower, you can barely see the wizard inside of a massive crystal sphere. Surrounding it are two additional crystal spheres, smaller. They are surrounding it as if the main one is kind of the planet, Toriel, and the two smaller one are its moons. And he's doing all kinds of things there. It seems like there are levers inside and switches, and he manipulates them while shrieking inside of this contraption. Lightning bolts kind of shoot up to the sky above you into that brain thing, and you do spot a hatch on the floor. So this is probably how he got up.
And the hatch is closed, yeah?
No, it's open. It's like a small wooden trap door.
Interesting. And is the door on the... See, it said it's on the bottom?
What door?
The door, the trap door.
No, we kind
of...
You kind
of... On the bottom of the sphere or on the side?
No, you climb. I mean, the trapdoor is on the roof. You climb out of it, and then you walk a couple of feet, and then you arrive at the massive sphere.
Okay. And how big is the sphere around?
It's like a half of a car.
Oh, okay. So it's not that big. So I'm. Oh, I can't. This has got to be a cantrip. I'm gonna go over to the hatch. I'm gonna. Can I get to the hatch, or I can put my head into the hatch?
Yeah, you can.
I'll poke my head and go. What's going on in here?
So that's
gonna be my whole turn.
Okay, so just to make it clear, because maybe I wasn't clear. Like the hatch is leading into the tower, right?
Into the sphere. How does he get into the sphere?
I figured that we are not. So you just So imagine it like this way. As you materialize on the roof, you can see the hatch, you can see the sphere, and right next to the wizard's right hand, there is a small rune that you believe that if you manage to activate it, it might open the hatch.
Right, and there's nothing I can do about that because I don't even have the mage hand cantrip. Okay, I have no spells. I think that would be helpful in this situation. So
you think that an arcana check can help you kind of figure out how to manipulate the rune?
Sure, I'll make an arcana check on the sphere and just see what I can learn about it. I'll spend my round, my action, investigating. Oh, that was shit. That's
a 10. A what?
A 10, total of 10.
Okay, so you know that the sphere is kind of a focal point for some interdimensional energy, but you, I mean, the rune is kind of a bit complicated. You can't really figure out how to use it, so you might need help. You do believe that, I mean, as you kind of look up, you see that the part of the brain that has gotten into this plane of existence, it is covered by tiny, tiny tentacles, and things kind of crawl on top of it, like tiny white spiders or something like that. You're not sure these are actual...
What part of it?
Like the brain, the part of it that kind of emerged into our plane of existence.
Right, okay. Okay, all right.
Okay, your elemental, do you want it to do something, or?
No, it's just going to stay there, like, kind of sink into the ground a bit so it's hidden, and just wait for my commands. It'll defend itself if it gets attacked, but otherwise it won't act.
Okay, makes sense. Okay, so... At this point, the skulls that are watching down and looking down towards the opening, they hover down to kind of be a face, at face level with you, and they look in your direction and they open their mouth toward basically everyone that are huddled in the opening. Behind them, you can hear the roar of the Minotaur, who I think that the Minotaur is still in the room, right? Or did I completely mess up the...
I think he's in...
He kind of pushed you out, right?
Yeah, he's either under something or something's on top of him. Or he's on top of something else. I can't remember. I think he might have fallen, or somebody fell on him.
I think he's in the doorway.
This is what I kind of have here. Okay, so the skulls, they hover, and then a couple of lightning bolts, like purplish lightning bolts from the cloud and the brain above them, kind of zap them, and out of their mouth they form what appears to be the interdimensional version of a fireball. So these are four fireballs that are exploding right into the middle of the tower.
Does that hit people who are lying in the doorway?
Yeah.
Like Rookie?
Yeah. So I need you all to make four saving throws.
Good game.
Rookie is dead.
Been swell.
Or dexterity saving
throws,
right?
Yes.
Is our paladin, the one who's up, close enough for us to be within 10 feet of him?
Yeah. You're kind of huddled together. That's fine.
James, is it a +3 you give, or...?
Yeah.
Okay, so my lowest dex save is a 15.
15.
Yeah.
Okay.
Milo's is a 16.
Oh, all the others are 20 or above.
All Okay, so for, let me just write it down, it will be easier. So to Galen, what's your like your rolls?
If you want them all, then it's 26, 15, 23, and 21.
Okay. Quirion.
16, a 16, and an 18, and a 24.
Okay. Forgar?
Math.
Nah. Okay. I'm writing it down. Nah.
Yeah. There's four of them, right?
Yeah.
I got a 13, a 13, a 17, and a 19.
19.
Wait, okay. I missed what this is about.
So we need to roll four saving throws.
Four saving throws, okay.
Yes.
Okay. And one more. Okay. So I got 15, 15, 11, and 13.
Okay. So we have one fail here, one fail here. Actually, Quirin, you're good. And Galen, you also have one failure. So, Galen, Forgar, and Peleus, and Rukvi, obviously, vanish. So, Quirin, you watch as your friend kind of being pummeled by bluish purplish energy. Those balls explode around you. The purple fire consumes four of your friends and they instantly disappear from existence. The Minotaur is hurled back into the tower. The shield guardian also is being pushed from the power of this explosion. The entire tower kind of rattles and they simply vanish, like disintegrated.
Wow, okay. All right.
And it is your turn, so how do you want to mourn?
The skulls are still there, right?
The skulls are still there, yes, kind of peeking into the tower.
I don't really know how I want to move. Brian's character is still up there on the tower, right?
I don't know that you would know that.
Yeah.
I don't know that. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to attack the skulls with my animated objects one more time.
Yeah.
Let's attack them. I'll have all of the attacks focus on two skulls. So it's five attacks each.
Okay.
The lowest one was a 15 plus 8 here, so I guess 23 hits, right?
Yes.
Okay, and the 21 also hits?
Yes.
Okay, so the first one got 5 hits. Second one got a critical miss, and does a 19 hit?
Yes.
Okay, so it got one got 4 hits, one got 5 hits, so the first one gets 42 points of damage for the first
42.
One.
Okay, amazing. Yeah.
The other one gets 24
points of damage. Okay, so the first one that you hit is hit so hard that its fiery magical aura kind of dissipates and it simply boom, 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 falls on the floor. The second one, how many hit points?
24.
Okay, so it kind of spins in midair, flies away, but then kind of goes back. Its magical aura still intact.
Okay, the huge brain.
Yeah.
How far is it from it?
So it's hovering kind of something like 80 feet above the tower. So you kind of only catch a small glimpse of it.
Huh. Okay. Okay. I'm going to dash dash back to the into the forest. Is it possible? I mean, how far am I from like cover from the forest?
It will take you more than a dash. I mean, you've cast the spell right now, so you only need like two rounds.
No, that was a bonus action.
Okay. So a dash will take you like 75% of the way.
Okay. And in that case.
And he's hit me.
Yeah, you're now invisible. You tilted the camera.
The camera move.
I'm going to cast Dimension Door to get as far away from into the forest. That takes me like 500 feet.
So wait, is it a cantrip? Like you cast a spell?
No, it's a spell. I didn't cast a spell. That was like the spell that I still had ongoing. It was a concentration. That was a concentration spell that I cast.
Got it.
Last time we met. Okay. That was animated object.
Okay.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to cast a spell to get away from it. Get away.
Okay.
To get as far into the woods as I can. And if I can do that using a move action, I'm going to communicate to our ship to come pick me up.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. Okay, so you kind of, a door materializes, you open it, pass through it, and you're gone into the woods. Can you tilt back your camera? Because all we can see is the ceiling of your...
Thanks.
That's from excitement. That's fine.
Yeah.
Forgar. Blue, purple energy engulf you. There's a searing pain. And then you find yourself, after all this energy kind of vanish, in a very small room together with your four friends. They are all caged up, each one in its own cage. There are several other cages in this place. Most of them contain people who simply babble. Kind of look at you. You're here with us. This is unbelievable. Oh my god. So like it's something like eight cages besides those cages that house you. There is an opening in the ceiling above you. The ceiling is full of what do you call those? You have stalagmites and stalactites, right? So yep. So stalactites, the ceiling is covered by them. And there is a hole in the middle of the room covered with bluish energy. And two mind flayers kind of hover above you. And they use those stalactites to kind of move. They push themselves and position themselves. And they look down at you and, you know, with their hands going like this. And then their tentacles kind of flail. It seems like they are communicating with each other. But you obviously don't understand what they're saying, if at all. What do you do?
So looking around, do I see that? Like, I know Rook V's down. Is he next to me? Can I reach him?
So he is in a cage. He's in a cage next to you. But you can't reach it. The cages, they fear from COVID, so they stay separated like 2 meters apart.
How do their masks work?
Yeah.
They're like gloves for, you know.
Oh, right, of course. Tentacles.
What do I do? I don't know. I don't know if, like, I really want to attack them right now. I'm feeling more like...
Okay.
Do I have an idea of where I could be? Like, is there a check I can make for them?
So roll for a perception check. And as you kind of, you look confused, you kind of look of, you know, what to do. Suddenly there's a voice inside of your head. 1, 2, 3, check. 1, 2, 3, check. Do you even understand me? And you hear another voice saying, I don't think he understands you. He won't make a good thrall, I'm afraid.
Okay. How
did you roll for perception?
Yeah, I got a 12.
Okay, so with a 12, all you can see behind those rows of cages, you think you're in a cave, probably deep beneath the ground. There are 12 cages all kind of arranged in a circle. Eight of them contains people who you don't know. Four of them contain you and your friends. Two mind flayers above, an energy sealed opening in the ceiling. And in the middle of the ring of cages, there is a small pedestal with what appears to be the imprint of a four-fingered hand.
Okay. Do I like... I don't know. I'm going to... I have no idea.
Okay. You want to think about it?
Straight up, I have no idea what I do.
Okay.
Padding is a perfectly valid option.
Yeah, I completely agree. In the meantime, upstairs, the Minotaur kind of raises its ugly head, shakes it, and growls at all of you.
Look, what have you done? There will be no chance of surviving it now.
And then he charges. At actually, no one. There is no one there. But he still says that for effect, like dramatic effect. Andreas, you might hear it because the hatch is open, and you can probably hear his angry cry. The shield guardian will wake up and look up and start climbing up. So this you can definitely hear, Andreas, kind of kling, 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 like an Autobot climbing the stairs. Mm-hmm. You believe that next round he'll be there. Let's go for...
Where I am.
Yeah, let's go for Rukvi. You need to make another death saving throw.
Thirteen.
Good, so two successes. Peleus. You're in a cage along with Forgar, who looks really confused. And Forgar, just tell me when you want to act, that's fine. Rukvi is still bleeding from the neck. Galen is kind of also there with you, looking puzzled. Yeah. What do you want to do?
I wanna, I guess, is there enough space to turn into like a bear or something?
Yes, to a bear, definitely.
Okay. Let me check how much.
You turn into something too big. With a lot of strength.
No, actually, is he got it? Right?
Something that has more strength. Okay, I guess. Yeah, well, at least 15 strength. So yeah, I'm gonna turn into a bear and attempt to bend the bars.
Okay, good. So as you do that, there is a voice suddenly in your head saying, "Oh, it's like the ones we captured before. They can shift their form. Let's call Sviglada. He'll know how to deal with this one. He'll be an excellent thrall." And one of the mind flayers kind of waves his tentacles at the energetic opening. The blue energy kind of it opens like an eyelid, and then he floats up, and then it closes, leaving you with only one mind flayer in the room. Make your roll.
Strength, I suppose, right?
Yes.
Okay, so that's a 14.
Okay, so 14 is not enough. You manage to kind of bend the bars just a little bit, with your strength, but you know, you kind of are not used to the claws, so you kind of fumble a little bit until you find like a good grasp. So maybe another attempt later on. Anything else you want to do?
Nope.
Okay. Galen, we're back.
My chance to look up and go, I want to do that. And try to break out in a similar strength fashion.
Okay, yeah, that's fine. Go ahead and do it.
Even with new dice, I can't roll. It's so an 11.
Okay, so you grab the bars and try to kind of force them apart. The illithid above you kind of looks at both of you with his glaring yellow eyes. And it seems like he's planning something. He is moving toward the pedestal. And all the other inmates kind of, oh, no. Oh my God, please don't. We'll behave. Galen, what do you want to do?
Yeah, the cage like hanging up in the air, like hanging or standing on the ground?
No, they're on the ground.
Okay, I will try and punch one of the bars with my fist that counts as magical, hoping
okay.
to
break it. Strength hasn't worked very well.
This is not strength, this is finesse.
Like in Kung Fu Panda, he grabs the bar and then ding, his finger goes up and then goes down.
Or more like Kill Bill with the 1-inch punch.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. It's a 27 to hit, so I assume I hit the bar.
Yeah.
I do 9 points of damage with the first punch.
Okay.
Does it have an effect?
Yes. You kind of bend it a little bit. You think that with a couple of more punches it will either break or bend in a way that will allow you to wiggle out.
Then I'll punch it again. 26 to hit, 8 points of damage.
Yes.
You're really good at punching bars.
Yes. I'm better at punching bars. bars.
Boom. Inspiration there.
Probably have inspiration. Do I have advantage to hit a bar?
No, it tries to move away each time you try to hit it.
Oh, well, it's a natural one.
Okay.
I'll spend a key point and do another bonus attack. I won't let this pointy metal thing that isn't moving, like, get out of the way. So that's a 22 to hit for 11 points of damage.
Okay, that's nearly enough. You believe that you've caused it a lot of damage. It's almost broken. Like you can feel the welding points about to give way. You think you'll need just one good punch to kind of break it.
So you know, not missing it once would have done it. Good. Good
to know. Yeah,
yeah. Told you, Bruce, it worked.
Anderist.
Hey, I'm almost out. Come on.
What do you want to do?
All right. Would a 15 radius sphere centered on myself completely black out the crystal sphere as well?
Yes. I mean, if you're close to it, this is what you mean.
Yeah, if I'm standing right beside it and holding a darkness spell. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so then I'll make sure that I'm adjacent to that crystal sphere. And I will use my Eyes of the Dark to, for the first time in this campaign, cast Darkness using 2 sorcery points.
Okay.
So what that means is I've cast Darkness on myself, but I can see through it. Nobody else can.
Amazing.
And I'll just cast it on a coin in my hand.
Okay. So.
And then I'm going. So go ahead.
No, go ahead.
What happens? No, what I happens? Want to see what his reaction is.
Darkness engulfs the sphere and its surrounding, and the wizards start shouting, "No, now I can't see a thing. I can't operate the damn thing. What happened? Oh, there's some kind of a spell. I know what to do. I know what to do." But he doesn't do anything right now because it isn't his turn.
So then I will use two more sorcery points to quicken cast a spell. Sorry, I'm using my D&D Beyond now to manage the character, so my character sheet. So it's taking me a little bit longer.
They have an app now.
I know. I haven't used it yet, but I've got my piece, my laptop in front of me, so I might as well. I'm going to quicken Blight on him.
Okay. So, but can you cast those two spells? Again, it's like the...
Yeah, the quicken spell allows me to just convert any spell into a... It doesn't say... I guess it's up to you. That would be your ruling.
So quicken makes it worth it. Yeah.
Yeah, just let me just pull it up here for you. You can cast a spell that's cast time with one action, two search points to change the cast to one bonus action for the casting. So will you, with the quicken spell, can I cast something that's not a cantrip?
No, I don't think so.
Okay, well then I won't cast Blight. Just for shits and giggles, I will cast Infestation on him.
What does that do?
Which, cantrip. Let me just pull it up here. I haven't cast it yet. It causes a cloud of mites, fleas, and other parasites that appear momentarily on one creature you can see within range. It must succeed on a con save or take some poison damage and move 5 feet in a random direction if it can move and its speed is at least 5.
Amazing. Okay. That's amazing, actually. So that's a total failure of his...
Cool catch-up.
Yes. So he completely fumbles his saving throw. That's a natural one there. So, he desperately tries to open the hatch to kind of, please, no! And can hear him kind of, you know, where's the spray?
He takes 3 points of poison damage.
Okay, but he flees.
Wait, I guess I'm a higher level, so he takes 5 points of poison damage.
Okay. He opens up the hatch and flees the crystal.
Perfect.
But again, in his turn, so let's see. It is interesting, actually.
He moves this round. It says only if he can move, so I don't know that, like, I guess he can move outside of it if he opens it.
Yeah,
but he moves on my turn.
Okay, got it. So he's out.
Yeah, it doesn't provoke opportunity attacks or anything, but
good. That's amazing.
It says if the direction rolled is blocked, the target doesn't move.
Now, if when you do that, what you can see is that the brain was on its way to kind of fully be inserted into this dimension, starts to kind of fall back a little bit, and the purplish energy that fuels the rift kind of is not flowing as it used to, probably because he's not manipulating the sphere.
Right.
So okay. There's that. Do you want the elemental to do something?
No, I'm going to keep him there for now. There's not much he can do. Can he come up the tower?
He can start climbing the stairs.
Can he climb up the outside of the tower?
Probably.
I don't think he could move through it, but...
No, you can...
I'd like for him to try that. Okay. Athletics check, I guess.
Yeah.
Oh, a natural 20. He got a 25.
Great. So let's assume he moved his entire movement up the tower.
60 feet. So he's up on top of the tower then.
Good. The skulls kind of go into the tower and scan it, but they don't find anyone. So they try and revert back to their previous location. So they get out of the tower and start climbing up, like floating up, but it will take them time to reach the top. So that's what they do. And we get to Quarian.
Okay, so Quarian is somewhere. So he ran over to the wood and he called up the ship. The idea is that to have the ship travel as fast as it can without going above the tree, above the treetops, if it can.
Okay. Yeah.
I want to check something. I forgot to check it before.
Okay. Forgar, you go ahead. Like until.
Okay. Sorry, I forgot to check it before.
Okay. I'm going to... He's heading for that center pedestal thing?
Yes, and all the inmates kind of shriek, no, we'll behave, we'll be good, don't do it.
Alright, so I'm going to cast Moonbeam on the tower then, like the pedestal.
Oh, that's cool. Okay, so remind me what Moonbeam does.
It's a partial radius and a 40 high cylinder.
Yeah.
So I don't know if it's going to hit the guy.
So he's not yet there, so let me know what it does, and then I'll tell you what happens if and when he touches it.
2d10 radiant damage on a saving throw.
Okay, and is it kind of something... Okay, and you can keep it kind of active, right?
Yeah.
That's amazing. That's actually amazing. Okay, very good. So you can definitely see that the elephant kind of reaches out to the pedestal, but then as the pedestal lights up with your divine energy, it kind of its tentacles kind of, you know, retract.
Shrivel.
Yeah, not shrivel, but retract. And he kind of looks at the this dark energy, at this bright energy with suspicion. And then he kind of looks at each one of you to kind of figure out who's doing it. Anything else you want to do?
I don't know. Would another attempt at trying to bust out this cage count?
Yeah, sure. Why not? Go ahead. I think it's all
right.
Maybe you'll need your action to actually do that. I'm not sure. And since you cast a spell, you know what? Go for it. Why not?
All right. That is a 16.
Okay, a 16 is almost enough. You kind of bend them just a little bit, but not quite there. Okay, obviously, those cages are adventurous proof. It will hold an adventurer for 2 rounds, guaranteed.
Amazon Basics adventure proof cages.
Yeah. So the mind flayer on his turn, he doesn't want to kind of touch the pedestal. You can see that. And as he withdraw from it, you can see all the inmates. Oh my God, thank you. Thank God, thank God. I mean, the Moradin, the mighty Moradin saved us. The Morning Lord, thank you very much. As the creature kind of doesn't do that. But then the creature turns its eyes on Galen, because he thinks Galen is the one who did the... he failed his... insight check. So and then he kind of, you know, mentally sneezes and casts it, he uses his mind blast kind of.
I don't want his germs, come on, get away from me. Come on.
Yeah, so let's see what does that do.
Is 4 guy within 10 feet of me?
No, because you are separated. You're separated by the cages.
Well, it's a 14 on my intelligence save.
So you all need to do that because it's a 60. It's a 60-foot cone. I would say that. It's probably Galen and someone and the one next to him. I'll roll randomly. Let's see. Okay, so it's Galen and another inmate. So you need to pass a DC 15 intelligence saving throw.
No? I'm using inspiration. It was a 14. I do have inspiration. Come on, I can do it. 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 I can. Hey, 21.
Okay, amazing. So, what happens if you make it? You make it. That's
that.
It is it. So, yeah.
Never
so
that would occur, so no
you
idea.
bite down the pain. There's some blood coming out of your nose, but other than that, you are fine. Which makes the mind flayer really, really pissed. At this point, the blue energy that wraps the top opening kind of again opens up, and another mind and the like. a third mind flayer that you haven't seen before, sticks his head out, but like, you know, inverted, so you can see his head kind of pops, and he, you need help. And the one that just tried to kind of zap you look up and says, now I'm fine. Just having a conversation with one of our inmates. And so the other mind flayer kind of, you know, does this and goes up again. This is actually the Shield Guardian's turn. So, but someone...
We skipped the Aquarian's turn before.
Okay. Yeah, so, you want to check something.
Yeah, I just want to make sure that my animated objects are still in my under my control when I'm up to 500 feet away from them, and they are.
Okay.
So I'm going to use them to attack 4 on one skull and 6 on another one that wasn't hit. So 4 okay. on the one that I hit before.
Okay.
Let's start with that.
So you basically fly back with your vessel, right? And then... Oh, no, you actually control it. Okay, got it.
Control it. So...
But how do you reach the top of the tower again?
I don't. My animated objects are still over there. My animated objects, they can be in a range of up to 500 feet away from me.
Oh, and wow.
That's the same amazing. Range that I have.
Remind me not to run adventures for high-level characters again. Okay, yeah, sure.
Okay, so this one I think only got one hit, right? This 14 probably doesn't hit it.
Let me tell you, how much? 14?
14.
14 actually hits.
Oh, okay, so that's 3 hits then. Four plus 12, that's 16 points of damage.
In addition to the 24, you destroy it. It falls down, as a regular skull. Boom, 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 boom.
So, a 13 probably doesn't hit the other one, right?
A 13 hits.
Awesome, okay. 4 hits. Alright, so 6 hits on the other one.
Ooh.
So that's 24 plus 10, 13, 18 plus 24, that is 42.
42 managed to destroy that one as well. So only one skull is basically floating above the tower right now.
Okay.
So that did you say only one left?
Yes.
Yeah.
So up on top of the tower, I'm watching these things just get like chipped to pieces.
Yeah.
Nice.
So that was like my bonus action. Waiting for our ship to arrive. So use my action to understand. What is this behemoth that's coming down from another dimension?
Make an
arcana. See the globe of darkness on top as well, right?
Yeah. So make an arcana check.
Okay. I got a 14.
Okay. So you realize that there is some combat, like magical combat going up the top of the tower. You can see a globe of darkness suddenly engulfing the device, and then those purple lightning bolts kind of cease for a moment. And then you can see that this rift beginning to close. So if no purple lightning, no rift opening, and the brain that was almost in your dimension is kind of receding back to its previous place, but it will take some time.
Does this brain look like a ship of some sort?
That might be it, yes.
Okay. Okay. Do I know how far our ship is?
It's close. Like, it can be, like, it flies really fast, so you can assume that if you want, you can get up into it, like in this round.
Okay, then I want to do that.
Okay, so you... Great, you climb back into the pilot seat, two tentacles up your eyes, and you fly it back to the tower. Great.
Yeah, I'm going to hover a bit before flying to the tower. I want to try to see if I can see anything new from the ship. I'm going to wait around before I fly over to the tower.
Okay, makes sense. So the shield guardian is finishing his climb into the top of the tower. So it bursts out of the hatch, but that is his entire movement, like entire turn. So he's standing up at the top of the tower right now. And the wizard. So let's assume that the wizard and the shield guardian act on the same turn. He bursts out of the darkness, kind of covered with bite marks from the fleas or flies or whatever that you've cast on him. And he looks up and he sees that the lightning has stopped and screams, "No, no!" And then he starts casting a spell of his own. So he will cast Dispel Magic. Now you guys know better than I how it works. So
third level and below would there be dispel?
Yeah. So is the magic magical darkness a third level or lower?
Oh yeah, magical darkness is second level. Does he have to dispel it on the item?
Choose one creature, object, or magical effect within range.
Magical effect. Okay. So yeah. The magical effect.
Okay, so he kind of waves it off and then strides back towards the sphere.
Is he able to get back into it this round?
I think so. I mean, this is his spell and he can walk to it. I mean, I'm assuming he didn't kind of...
He didn't go far when he left.
Yeah.
Well, I guess he had to walk out of my darkness, so he had to walk at least 15 feet.
Yeah, that's fine. But
and he doesn't do anything about me.
No, he kind of ignores you completely. You don't exist. He simply walks. So you know, like a pompous, self-important man. He kind of you don't exist. I just simply going back to the car. So he kind of starts manipulating the controls again, but not really. I mean, he finishes his turn inside the sphere, but he's not activating it yet.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead again.
Rukvi.
Let's do it. Come on. 20. Nope. But I'm stable.
Okay, you're stable. That's amazing.
I think okay. Perhaps the Sahlagin just puts his hand and applies pressure to my neck. I see you got teleported as well.
Okay, okay. Well, yeah, I'll accept that. Peleus, Mr. Bear.
Yeah, let's finally break out of this cage. I will try once more to break this. And that's a 21.
Oh, amazing. So the bars kind of bend. In a way that creates an opening large enough for your bear form to pass through. That's amazing. The mind flare immediately kind of fixate on you as you do that.
Yeah, I will pass through and I will leave enough room so that the other guys can leave the cage. But
it's only you. Like it's one cage per adventurer.
Oh.
Yeah, the warranty doesn't kind of hold if you lock two adventurers in one cage.
Okay.
That's right. You have to use it for its intended purpose.
Yeah.
Okay. I think I will get into melee range of the...
So he's up there flying, hovering above, like at jump. The... yeah, what?
I will jump really high.
Oh, okay. That yeah, you can try. You can definitely try.
No, I mean, I can't attack anyways.
Okay. But you're out. That's amazing. We're back to Galen.
Yeah, I want to get out of two. Come on. 23 to hit that bar.
Yes.
For 10 points of damage.
Yeah, so a bar kind of with your fist kind of flies and leaves an opening for you to pass through.
Yeah. Come on, Fall Guy, we need you out here. I say yes, I run out. Or squeeze out of them. How high up is the Mind Flayer?
So it's kind of a 60 feet tall room. Not room, like a chamber, underground chamber. The tallest stalactite is roughly half the size of the half the height of the room, so 30 feet.
Yeah, but how high is the mind flayer up?
Oh, he's something like 40 to 50 feet up there. So he kind of went down to touch the pedestal, but then Forgar lighted it up, so he kind of retracted or like went back and then tried to mind blast you, which he failed. So he's keeping his distance right now.
That's not fair. Totally not fair.
Yeah. So eventually what holds you, like what's holding the mighty adventurer from slaying the monster is 30 feet. This is like the...
how close is this to like the edges of the room?
How what?
How close is the mind flayer to the edges of the room, like the wall of the room?
Is
that close to anything that I could like run up?
So I would say that he's halfway there because he was attempting to go to the pedestal, which is in the middle of the room, and then he went back. So probably 15 feet from the wall.
Okay. So I could, with step of the wind and everything, get a really high like jumps and movement speed. So I'll just run over to the wall, run up the wall, jump out from the wall towards him.
Yes.
And then with my second attack, which is the only thing I have left, punch him. And totally not whiff. Come on. Don't whiff. A 16 to hit?
A 16 to hit. That's interesting. Let's see. Yes, actually, yes. You hit it.
I was worried there for a minute. I only do 12 points of damage, but I will also try to stun him with my like awesome maneuvers here.
Okay. Wait. I need to write it down. How many points of damage?
12 points of damage. And then okay. A constitution save. DC 15.
Yeah, that won't... He won't pass it if I'll roll my d12. Oh, a natural one. Amazing.
That's
so
good.
So he
is stunned until the end of my next round.
Okay, so he kind of hovers.
He falls down.
So he levitates duration, and it's not a... Oh, it is a concentration check, yeah.
Could I grab onto him to, like, help him float down as I...
You want to help him float down?
Yeah, you could. If I could just like grab onto him.
Yeah, make
I'm
a. Yeah, sure. He's stunned. He's not doing anything. So sure.
Okay. I'll be holding onto him.
Okay, and so you two kind of. Yeah, you two float down. Oh, I have the stunned. Incapacitated, can move. The creature automatically fail. Attack rolls against the creature have advantage. Incapacitated. Yeah. Okay, so when this happens, wait, this is Galen, so yeah, it's not his turn yet. Okay, good, cool. So one mind flayer is going down, and all the inmates kind of they kind of clap, and then one of them pukes. Anderist.
Okay, so there's a trap door in the floor, and I can hear something coming upwards.
Yes, the shield heavy. Guardian is big and heavy, exactly.
If my earth elemental was standing on top of that trapdoor, could he still reach the crystal sphere?
No. Like, what's his reach? It's like 10 feet or 5 feet?
He's just a large creature. He doesn't have reach.
So okay, so yeah. So he can't reach the sphere.
He can't?
No.
Okay, that's fine for now. How close is that? Can I estimate, you know, is that thing close to coming out the trapdoor?
You believe it will come out of the, like it has come out of the trapdoor. You can see the its shoulders and head, but he hasn't burst out yet.
Okay, so I'll command the Earth Elemental to go over and stomp on that trapdoor.
Okay, yeah, makes sense.
And can we do that right now?
Yes. So you want it so to hold the trapdoor kind of, so make simply a grapple check, that's fine, like a strength check or athletic. Yeah. Strength athletics.
Ooh, 19, 24.
Good. So, just for the fun of it, the Shield Guardian didn't do that well, I think. Shield Guardian. So, that's actually a 14. So, your elemental manages to kind of push down on the creature.
Can we call it a slam attack? Can we call it a slam attack and just have him stomp it? So we can
take
sure. damage too?
Yeah, go for it.
So 5, 6, 7, 8, 13, unless it is a object or structure. I guess it's not. It's a construct, but not a structure.
Yeah. Amazing.
So just 13. And then, so I'm going to bonus action summon my Hound of Ill Omen.
Okay.
And I'm going to summon it inside the crystal sphere right behind the wizard. And so next round, he'll get to go. I have down that, but I need to 1, 2, 3 sorcery points to do that, and then I'm going to cast blight, but I'm going to heighten it so that another 3 sorcery points.
So what blight?
So that he has disadvantage on his save. Oh no, I don't need to do that. Sorry, my hound is there. Sorry, I forgot. The hound gives him disadvantage on his saves, so I'm going to cast blight on him.
Okay.
So he needs to make a constitution save at disadvantage.
Okay. That's an 11 and a... So 11 constitution with... Let me tell you his... come on. So that's a 12.
Yeah, you fail. 8, 16... 19, 24, 27, 33 points of necrotic damage. Oh, I forgot. I had used my necrotic shroud when we came out of the ship. I brought my wings out.
Mm-hmm.
So he actually takes, what did I say that was?
30 something.
Anybody remember? I was saying it was 8. Oh, I moved all the dice. Okay, we'll say it was 33. So he takes 45 points of damage. And
amazing.
I didn't add that extra 12 points last round when he took the damage from infestation.
Okay. That's okay. Mine. Amazing. Okay, so his skin kind of shrivels and kind of, you know, bleeding wounds appear all over his body. He shrieks from agony. And then you can see that he kind of turns his gaze to you. So he noticed you now.
Good.
Yeah. That's awesome. Great round. And the elemental...
Can I use my movement to move behind the elemental so that I've got cover?
So the elemental and the shield guardian kind of fight. You're not sure you want to be there when...
Okay, it's looking that strong. I will stay away then.
Okay, good. So the skull that is at the tower, above the tower, there is one left, right? Yes. So it will look at you, Andres, and open its mouth and emit this single purplish fireball at you.
Is it a spell?
Yes.
Counterspell.
Awesome. So what does it do?
it's a third level or lower spell. It has no effect.
No effect. Okay. So yeah, it dissipates in front of you. The skull looks... pissed.
Good.
Amazing. Quirion, what do you want to do?
Okay, so first of all, I'll use my animated objects to attack that skull again.
Yeah.
Thank you.
The only skull, so it's 10 hits. So
oh my god.
That's
poor skull. Her name was Maggie, by the way. Just killed, like a named skull.
Good. Good. I knew somebody named Maggie. I hated her. Kill it.
Okay.
Yeah. So, as simple as 64 times and the power of 41. 6. Ching, ching. What?
Carry the one.
41 points of damage.
Okay, it falls down the steps. Like it kind of, all the magical energy is sucked into it, and then it falls straight down into the shaft and ting, 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 down the stairs.
So that was like my bonus action. Now I want to do this. I want to use the ship to ram this. This thing that the wizard is inside, I want to knock it off the building.
Oh my god! Oh my god!
Like a hamster ball.
Oh my god!
Exactly.
This is
While the Hound of Illumine bites on his balls, right? Like
yeah, exactly.
This withering.
What I didn't tell you is that my hound is actually a chihuahua.
Well, that's even worse. They're like a big hound, like the chihuahuas are the worst.
Exactly.
So I need you to make an attack roll. Simply attack it like as if you're attacking something with your own weapons, like dagger or something like that.
Okay. I don't remember how I attack with weapons. So that's a plus 8.
Okay. So the ship kind of sprouts tentacles at the forefront of it, and they...
That's an 18 plus 7, so 25.
Amazing. So you kind of smack it out of the top of the tower like a golf, you know, a player kind of smacks a ball. So poof, it flies into the air, and then all the purplish lightning kind of, you know, goes wild and explodes and lightnings, etc. And just before it kind of begins to fall down, a tentacle sprouts out of the brain that is almost gone now. It snatches the sphere, and with its shrieking content, like the wizard, swallows it, and then the rift closes. You can only hear the echo of the wizard's scream, like, no! And then he's gone.
Awesome.
That's amazing.
I open the window. Hey, Anders, do you need a ride?
I look at my Earth Elemental and Fluffy, who's now gone.
Oh, he'll be back.
Fluffy is still alive and still angry and attacking that wizard, by the way.
Yeah.
We don't have, doesn't say anything about us having to be on the same plane of existence.
Yeah.
So he will continue, that dire wolf will continue to attack him.
Oh my god.
I've pointed at the trapdoor. You can probably see that bouncing up and down at the Earth Elemental trying to hold it down.
Oh, okay.
There's something here.
Okay, sure. We can do this from the ship, or you can do it from over there.
Well, I would prefer to get on the ship, but that won't happen till my turn.
Sure.
Okay. Forgar, so that was an amazing use of an Autoloid. Forgar.
Yeah, so brute strength. Totally. I can make this. I can break out of this stupid adventure proof case. No, I can't. I don't know, a 10 strength check will break the last of it out.
Okay, so you got a little strain on the bars, you fart, but you know, yeah, nothing really happened.
Come on. Yeah, not trouble. You don't need to add to the trouble here. Like, that's
sitting there, like, bombing on the metal bar. Like,
thank God you're not a green dragonborn.
Now, I just need to quickly see what happens. Just a second. I actually don't know what happens to the shield guardian if it's wizard. As long as the same plane of existence. Oh, this is amazing. So yeah, they're not on the same plane of existence, and therefore the shield guardian kind of shuts down.
Oh,
wow. That's cool. Yeah, so that's that. And We go back to Rukvin, and at this point I just need to remind you that I did miss the other mind flayers. So energy seal kind of opens up, a mind flayer pops his head, watches Galen spiral down, dancing with the other mind flayer. This mind flayer kind of rolls its eyes as if, you know, oh god, I need to do this now by myself. And he tries to blast you with his psychic energy. So it's a cone, 60 feet cone. He's doing it again.
How did the mind flayer to say, like, hey, everything is good? Like, thumbs up.
No.
Fine.
Is there a ventriloquist check?
But I assume the mind flayer also get hit.
He's incapacitated already, so.
Yeah, but he takes damage.
Yeah, probably. Ooh, amazing. Nice. Yeah, so more blood from your eyes, from your nose. And he kind of. So his tentacles kind of wiggle, and then he thinks a little bit. And then you can see him go up and say something, like verbally, to someone who is up there. And he says, in common, release the eyewitness. Release the eyewitness. Maybe like the first time it didn't sound kind of sinister enough, but...
You got it there. There's something else coming. Come on, Forgar, we need you.
Are you guys going to do something with Rukvi? Peleus, what do you do? Like, Rukvi is...
I'm trying. Yes. I would love to help him.
I can go over and kick him. That's what I can help him.
Come on,
yeah, no, I think it's probably best if I help him out and try to get him out of there.
Maybe heal Rukvi?
Yeah, get me up so I can spend 3 actions trying to break out of this cage as well.
Yeah, sure. He'll heal you from the outside, like just touch you through the cage, and then.
Yeah, I do need to touch you though.
Social distancing is not allowed.
Yeah, what do you do, Peleus? You definitely know that something is coming in. You also heard that Mind Flayer say, release the eyewitness.
No, I will cast... if I can get my hands on the body of Rukvi, I will cast Cure Wounds on him.
Okay. Rukvi, you're cured.
Alright.
Let's see. I'm gonna use like a 4th level spell slot. So that is...
plus... Psychic.
Like 26.
Hell yeah. Alright. It's not my turn, right?
No, Peleus is actually after you, so you'll have to wait for another round. But you're up, so that's good. Peleus, any other thing? Any other...
No, I will keep standing in front of this cage. Kind of block it a little bit.
Okay, good. Galen, what do you want to do?
Did the mind flayer take any damage from the mind blast from the other one?
Yeah. You think so? You kind of rule that.
Then I will try to kill him if we're still floating. I don't know if you're still floating down or not, but I will try to kill him.
Yeah, okay, go for it.
You can use him as like a floating platform and jump onto the other guy.
No, but the other guy's he's gone again, sadly, so I can't jump up and, you know, just clear the ship. while the rest of them try to get out of a single cage. Come on.
Yes, you can. Please do.
I
will. We need you.
Yes. That's a 16 to hit, 21, 27, and a crit.
Yeah. All hit.
Yes.
You have advantage on all of those
yes,
now.
Yes, yeah, that was with advantage, and I did need that to make them all hit. So that's 20, 30, 44.
44. So you kind of poof, 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 and the last punch kind of, you can hear bone snapping, and then the tentacles kind of, you know, fall down, and greenish, bluish, whitish material starts to ooze from its mouth.
Good.
Gross.
Yes.
It's still floating.
I will tear off a few of its tentacles. Yes.
Ew.
Because it's disgusting and I want to do it.
You're like calamari on the bar to be like, dude, gross.
Andrus makes an excellent tzatziki sauce, so we can do some calamari.
Good leadership.
Okay, amazing. Thank you, Galen. Andrus, what do you want to do?
Well, so my hound rolled a 23 to hit, and he does 8 damage against the wizard.
So your hound basically went to the equivalent of the event horizon black hole. So he kind of was sucked into some dimension that really he isn't very comfortable there. So yeah, we can assume that
he's never comfortable.
He's gone into some other adventure of his own. We'll see what comes.
Yeah, but what if he kills the wizard?
Where he goes, we need no eyes. Yeah, so.
Oh, after I finish up the mind flare, by the way, I will run over to Forgar's cage to, like, help him. I break out of this cage, or I'll do something with these tentacles.
While Fluffy's tearing a wizard to pieces inside a crystal sphere in some sort of hellscape, I'm going to get my earth elemental to tear the hatch off and toss it, and then turn that whatever helmed horror into scrap metal. And while he's doing that, I'm going to go down the tower looking for my friends. As far as I know, everybody's downstairs. They're not making any noise, so they're probably dead. Yeah, I don't know that. I know is it went quiet down there.
Right.
And purple lightning.
Well, the purple lightning was around me. That was around me. I wouldn't have seen that if it was inside the tower.
So you and Quirin, you're both at the same kind of turn. Now there's nothing in between. So you go to the bottom of the tower, but you see no trace of your friends. There is only this residue on the walls and the carpet and the broken table. That's some sort of a great magical effect exploded inside of the room. If you want, you can do an arcana check to ascertain its source.
That's probably a good roll.
That would be a 25.
A 25 reveals that something of a teleportation spell kind of exploded into this area. You believe, you have a good reason to believe that your friends were affected. So they were
the Minotaur not here?
Nope.
Okay, well then I'm going to investigate and search. Okay. I'll spend some time searching this tower.
Good. Roll your investigation check.
Ooh. I'm super good at investigation. I got a 4.
Okay. So you kind of
this
stare.
This house is clean.
Okay. Quirin, what do you want to do while Andrus kind of is wandering at the kitchen making tea or something like that?
I'm going to take the ship for a short spin around the building.
Okay.
To see if there's anybody still down, any enemies still down there. I believe I saw the Minotaur before I ran away. Is he still down there?
So you do a circle around the tower and you don't see the Minotaur, but you do see footsteps, kind of cloven hooved footsteps lead to the forest. So you do have a reason to believe that he fled in that direction.
Got it. Okay, so in that case, I'm going to exit the Nautiloid at the base of the building and send it again to some other hiding spot in the forest, and and start doing a search on the first floor to see if I can find anything.
Roll your investigation check.
Okay. Yeah, I'm about as good as Andrist.
Okay, so you two kind of sit at the table in the kitchen, making tea, talk about like your adventuring life, what happened, and
braid each other's hair.
Yeah.
You see how I knocked that thing off the building?
That was amazing. That was amazing.
Braid each other's.
See how dark it was.
Unbelievable!
Amazing when I sucked all the life energy out of him.
Yeah, totally.
Forgar. You have a feeling, kind of can't get that image out of your head of your friends somewhere drinking tea. But what do you do?
I really want some tea.
Well, you better get out of that cage.
Man, I have tried.
Come on, I'm here to motivate you.
Like, yeah, all you're doing is just being like, bend a bar, bend a bar.
I cast motivational poster. Little cat, hang in there. Yeah.
So are you out of the cage yet, or?
No, I am making yet another strength test.
Yeah, I can do that all day.
I think you can get it done. I'm here to
move. Yeah, this cage can go all day.
Come on, with advantage. You can do
20.
It.
Yeah, he did it.
Oh yeah, with advantage? That fuck advantage. Your advantage sucked.
I have a tentacle here, and I'm ready to like put it somewhere you don't want maybe to.
Amazing.
Put it.
So you break out of the cage eventually, and you kind of raise your hands in
roar.
Yeah. Roar. And then you all hear something like a voice mumbling, and then another voice on top of it, and then another like 10,000 voices on top of it. It's a cacophony of voices speaking at the same time. It's like you are in the middle of a city and everyone are speaking, and you can hear in your mind all of those people. And then
put me back in the cage, put me back in the cage.
the energetic opening kind of opens, and a tentacle that ends with an eyeball kind of give me some descriptive term to this motion. What?
Dips down?
Dips down, yes. Let's go with dips down. Picks in another one of them, and then another one, and then another one. And each of these eyes are so alien, so not human, that your skin kind of develops, you know, goosebumps. And then there's this mass of reddish, purplish flesh plugs itself into the hole, and then... falls down from it, hovers in the middle of the room with 16 eyes surrounding it, attached to tentacles. And this thing simply fixates on all of you, and you start to feel very, very like, you know, something is going on and it's not good. So, the first... I watches, so we have 1, 2, 3, 4. Where's my d4? Okay, so the first I is on number 3, lucky number 3, that's Peleus. Peleus. Wait, I'm excited. Make an a charisma saving throw.
Okay, charisma saving.
Nice.
Okay, that's a 5.
A 5, good. So, do you know that feeling where you can see a cockroach and it kind of runs to you? So you get all this like so this is exactly how you feel. So for 1 minute, all you can do is simply get as far away as possible from this creature doing this.
Professor, but if he's 10 feet away from me, he can't be frightened.
So this isn't frightened. This is something else. It actually doesn't say anything other than it. The target can simply, it simply has
it's
to
repulsion, isn't it?
Yeah, it's like aversion or something like that. It's not the spell. But that was a good. So you have disadvantage on attack rolls for 1 minute, and at the end of each of your turn, you can retrade that saving throw. But remember, you have to do this as you kind of brush away. So that was the first attack. The second attack is at number two, who is Forgar. Make an intelligence saving throw for me.
Oh, that's his best stat.
That's the bad one.
He's an intelligence-based paladin.
Totally. 17.
17 is actually amazing. That's actually amazing. Right? Yes, you are hit by a pure white energy ray made of psychic energy. It kind of catches you right in your forehead. You kind of shout for, kind of shake for a couple of seconds, but then you grit your teeth and you kind of push back. All those images of hellish, nightmarish, tentacled, hairy monsters, you kind of push it back and you manage to avert this this ray. So this is amazing. The next attack is number four. So this is Galen, I assume? Yes, Galen. I need you to make a constitution saving throw.
Ooh. well, I get a plus three from Forgar since I'm next to him, so seven.
Seven is amazing. So one of those eyes kind of looks at you, and then you kind of, you know, prepare yourself with your fists up, and then you can see on the palm, like on this part of your hands, an eyelid kind of opens, and then on this hand, an eyelid, and on your palm, an eyelid, and on your body, and on your feet, and everywhere on in your body, eyelids kind of open, and eyes are looking at you, and you start to drool, and you are basically stunned for 1 minute. Mm. 1 minute, and again, you can do this, like, repeat the saving throw.
Yeah, at the end of the next turn.
Yeah, there is another ray. Let's see who gets it. Number four again. So this is.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so you need to make a strength saving throw, and I think it's with the disadvantage if you are stunned. Let me tell you. Yeah. Oh, no, you automatically fail strength and dexterity saving throws. So you can see Galen starts to kind of float toward this mass of flesh. And then the mass of flesh kind of moves to the side a little bit to reveal the hole. And then you can see eight spider legs kind of emerge and engulf Galen and simply go up, and he disappears inside that hole upstairs.
I got him right where I want him. Don't worry. I would say that if I could. I'll just
put a bit.
Yeah.
Prepare as a monster for a root canal, Doctor.
Yeah. So that was their turn. So, Rukvi, what do you do?
Well, I woke up from a dream playing with kitties, and I come to this
horrible nightmare of illithids in cages. And
there's one illithid still left floating around in here.
No, only the one Galen kind of brought down. So he I think he's dead, right? Yeah. So yeah. He's dead. He's still floating, but he's dead. And okay. there's a huge mass of pink flesh with many tentacled eyes floating around, and something spidery just took Galen up the chimney, up the hole above.
Is how far off the ground is this?
60 feet. But there are stalactites that go down up to 30 feet into the room. So if you can manage a 30 feet jump or something like that, you probably could grab one of the stalactites and climb up if you want.
Well, yes, Misty Step is actually up to 30 feet, so I'm okay. going to use Misty Step.
Okay, achoo! And you disappear and reappear on one of the stalactites.
Come on, so make... that's how you get out of a cage.
Yeah, there we go. no need to break anything.
The fire thing on the pedestal. I didn't want to mess with that.
Yeah.
Oath of Vengeance.
So make so make a strength athletics check if you want to continue up the.
Come on, I got plus 8, 25.
Yeah, so you managed to climb all the way up into that opening. So
do I see Galen's any body parts still going up?
Yes, make a perception check. It's dark up there, but you can see something.
9.
So all you can see is a mighty, not a mighty, but a huge bloated body of a black spider that kind of took him up and is now busy wrapping him in something. But you can't see the whole of the spider, just the backside of it.
Do I still have more actions to try to jump up and grab Galen?
So you told me like the Misty Step is an action probably, right?
Bonus action.
And then you climb, so that was your move. So yeah, I assume so. You still have your action.
All right, then I would like to jump and grab Galen, and maybe how big is the hole?
Enough for you to pass. No problem at all.
All right. Can I put my legs up against the hole and pull Galen down, perhaps?
Oh, like Van Damme. You can probably do that. There's no role for that, I assume, but...
Just forget about children.
Yeah, you can do that. You can do that. No problem. So you quickly climb the tube and then position your two legs, like, spread them across the opening and then pull Galen. So make another strength check.
All right. Oh my god, an 8.
Oh, so you tug him, and then it kind of makes the spider turn around, and you can see that this isn't a spider. It is a woman with the lower part of a, like, the from the waist down, she's a spider, like a huge one. But the from the waist up, it is a female draw. And she kind of, you know, her fangs, her whole mouth is kind of mutilated and cracked and opened, like a spider grew inside of it or something like that. And she's drooling as she kind of wraps Galen with her webbing. And then she turns to you.
I just yell, but I'm guessing we're still playing a tug of war here?
Yeah, that's fine.
All right.
So that was Rukvi. Peleus. So at the end of your turn, you can repeat the saving throw.
Mm-hmm. Only at the end. So my turn will be spent running away?
I assume so. And then you kind of try to break free of it.
Okay, I guess. And that's an 8. So.
Okay, so you keep kind of.
Dude, I live next to the forest right now, and I got so many like mosquitoes and shit in here like every day. I'm not scared of anything.
Oh my god.
That's a real test of your ability to roleplay, kind of. Yeah. If there was a cockroach now, this session would end right now, and I wouldn't even stop the camera. I'll be simply gone. Okay, so that was Peleus.
live in a country without cockroaches.
Yeah, we don't have cockroaches here.
What?
Yeah.
How did that happen?
Cockroaches can't survive, you know, Scandinavian winters.
Yeah, they don't like Canadian winters either.
They can survive.
They always told me they would survive, like, a nuclear apocalypse somehow.
But yeah, they like the heat. Climate.
But in a nice warm place.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah, they don't come up north much because the temperatures. They don't like it.
Do you see this rat?
Yes.
Yeah.
It was in the gutter, just like on the other building, right next to my.
What?
It was just.
It looked like a cartoon.
It looked at me and it was just like, "Hey, what's up?" And I was just like, "Hey," like at my sister then, like, "What? There's a giant rat." And the rat was just looking at us, like, did not even care. Didn't matter. God. The cats doesn't matter. Like, he would probably beat up my cats.
Galen, what do you want to do?
Not get eaten.
Okay, so
I can't do anything other than, like, drool a bit and then try to do my save again.
Yes.
15 this
time? No.
So what, do I get a bonus from...
So Rukvi is near you. Rukvi is near you. I don't know if he has, like, this aura.
Plus four. When you make a saving throw, any saving throw, apparently.
Nice.
19, then.
And 19, you wake up and you kind of shake yourself and you kind of find yourself very close to the bottom of a giant spider, or should I say a drider, Rukvi pulling your legs.
Yes, I will do a manly scream, like.
Mr. Frodo.
Maybe
Homer Simpson.
Rukvi, help me. You know, very badly.
Stand still.
Like, I can do this. And how trapped am I by the webbing by now?
Oh my God. So yeah, it's kind of a, you'll need to wiggle out of it. So
yeah. I don't think I have a choice.
Okay. So this is a turn well spent.
Yes.
Okay. Enderist, what do you want to do?
So what do I know of this tower now? Like, is it, how many floors are there? Are there rooms? Is it just like a big cylinder?
It's a big cylinder. There are the floor that you are in is basically a kitchen, and there was a table in the middle of it. There are some closets, what probably used to be a rug. And then exactly like this, like it's a staircase that leads up to the top. It's empty, hollow. At the top there is a hovering chandelier, basically, and then the hatch.
There's nothing here.
Yeah. So
it doesn't even look like there's not even like a bedroom or anything, right? Like
right.
Okay, so while I'm enjoying my tea, I'm going to have my earth elemental. I'm just be like, can you make a hole in this? And I'm going to point at the floor. So I just want him to just start pounding on the floor, see if there's something underneath.
Okay. Yeah.
Because
my
investigation check didn't find anything, I'm gonna go with brute force.
Okay. So you kind of, you know, dirt flies up to the air, and after like a couple of minutes, he stops and then says, looks at you and says, "There's some wet material here."
What is it? I can go look.
You look, and it looks like he uncovered a brain. Like a brain tissue. Brain tissue, like a meter on a meter.
Where's the zombie when he needs them?
Over to Quarian. What? All right, well, I guess that's my turn. I don't know what to do here.
Okay, let's take a look. Is it
I'll get him to start. Let's excavate around it, right? Like,
okay,
let's figure this thing out and see what we got.
Quarian, as his earth elemental uncovers more and more brain,
I'm going to try go check the desk that crashed. Is there any drawers or anything that inside it? Any letters? Any
So it looks like it was a wooden desk. There was it was covered by a piece of cloth and probably a vase or something like that. It was made in Waterdeep. You recognize the symbol of the wood carver that made it. You do find among the rubble that the desk was totally crashed, like something that appears to be a mummified hand, like this size.
Shit, we found the claw of Vec.
Okay.
Maybe it was in a vase. It appears so.
In a vase?
Yeah, so the on the table there was a vase, and instead of flowers, you believe this mummified hand was kind of put inside of it. So it's mostly shattered, but you can definitely, make sense of it. So,
do I know like anything about mummified hand? Is there mummified hands?
Well, yes, I do.
Can it? It's like an arcana check, or...
So you kind of pass it to Andres, and between the two of you, you make a history check, actually.
That's probably going to be your skill set. Well, I got a plus 6, but I'm assuming yours is better.
Let me check. I'm not sure at all. History. I got a plus 4. You go. I'll help you.
No, that didn't matter. 10.
So it's either a glorified back scratcher or something relates to the Wizards of Thai and maybe their maybe a ritual they did or something ceremonial, but it is definitely a relic that belongs in the land of Thai.
Well, when we've got time, we can detect magic on it and stuff, right?
Yeah. Okay. Can we poke the brain with like a stick, some glorified stick from the area, or anything from, or debris? Throw debris at it.
Yeah, you can. So it is the material itself is strong enough so that the earth elemental could stand on it, but you can definitely try and kind of wound it, if that's what you. Okay.
I'm going to cast like a vicious mockery on it. Does psychic damage to it.
Oh, that's cool. Okay.
So it needs to do a saving throw on it. Yeah, wisdom saving throw, DC 17. If not, I cause it a few points of damage. Nothing serious.
So you cast vicious mockery on it. And then parts of the brain starts to move, okay, and then more parts of it starts to split like tear, and then chunks of it kind of fall apart, and they are still on the surface of the brain, but chunks of it kind of are separated from it. And you hear this voice inside of your head saying, "Eat your fill of knowledge, but remember, too much greed backfires."
Well, there is a kitchen.
My fill of knowledge?
I could whip us up a stir fry.
Could we check if it's connected to anything?
Yeah, that's what I was hoping to do, to excavate underneath it, right? See if it's actually connected to something else or if it's just buried.
So you want to kind of excavate deep inside?
Yeah, well, I'm hoping that the elemental will be able to get underneath it eventually, even if it's to push it. So I want to see if its brainstem is attached to anything. But while he's doing that, yeah, I will collect a couple of handfuls of that brain matter that fell off.
Yep.
And take them to the kitchen.
Okay.
I'm going to go Hannibal Lecter.
You're going to eat it?
Yeah. Aren't you?
Saute some mushrooms, some garlic, and a bit of butter.
Right, exactly. some celery, some carrot.
Yummy.
Bam. Does it matter? There was a voice inside my head that said to eat it. I always do what the voices in my head tell me.
So Galen is and Rukvi are playing catch with a Dryder. Forgar and Peleus are down there with Peleus kind of cockroaches. And Forgar, remind me what your status is.
Free of the cage is my status. That's, okay. That's what I got.
How many experience points did I get for destroying that cage?
Okay, and Galen is basically he cuddles with the Dryder while Andrest is cooking up brain tissue with Quarian kind of glancing between him and the Earth Elemental, who kind of uncovers more and more brain material as it widens the circumference of his excavation.
Andrus has got like an apron on all of a sudden.
I think this is like a perfect time to end this session, and think where should I, like there's no way to go like up or down from where we are. It's kind of perfect. Let's freeze it, save, and then
F5 everybody.
Perfect place to end the campaign. Like, it makes total sense. Everybody's in the right place.
Just as we started it, total sense.
Just happy ending all around.
Yes. Exactly. Amazing. Wow. Okay, good. I have lots of notes to compile, so.
I do have a quick question. Does Rukri recognize the Dryder? Is it like a drow, or is it like another type of ill with women he might recognize that been turned into a monster?
That's a great question, but no, actually doesn't recognize it. It is it looks like a drow, not like his ex, which is where is his ex? Yeah. This is a good question.
Yeah, it would have been perfect if that was her.
I don't know if Rupi was currently concerned about that at this very moment.
Galen wouldn't be either, but hey, she's my girlfriend now. She's totally into bondage. I'm so into this.
To the drow? I mean, yeah.
Please get me out of this. Help!
I might just pull out your legs.
That's fine. Just get me away.
Awesome. So, any plans for the weekend, or are we simply going to stay in quarantine and...
I have one bullet point in my list to do, and it's go to bed. That's my
Amazing. Good. Great, guys. So, thank you very much. Have a good one.
Yeah, have a good weekend.
See you in 2 weeks.
Bye, guys.
Nice. See you.
Have a good one. Night.